We practice leadership at different points and in different ways, sometimes with greater skill than others, right? And today, that's what this is about, is a chance to get together and talk about women in leadership and how we can be better leaders and how we can support each other in that endeavor to be leaders in our businesses, our families, our communities, our neighborhoods. And I'm glad to have you here today. It's good to see so many faces I know and so many faces I don't know. So I'm looking forward to meeting more of you and getting to know what roles you're playing in your lives. Our first speaker today is Colleen Juergensen. Colleen is the president of the Dillon Stores Division, based here in Hutchinson. She's responsible for 80 stores in Kansas, Missouri, and Nebraska, and they fall under the headings of Dillons, the Gerbs, and Bakers. The stores employ more than 12,500 associates. Colleen is a graduate of Barton County Community College. She began her career with Dillon Stores in 1981 and has served in various leadership roles throughout the division, including store director, district manager, and director of advertising. She was promoted to vice president of operations in 2008. And in 2012, Colleen moved to the Smith's Food and Drug Division to take on the role of vice president of operations, followed by vice president of merchandising. She was named to her current role of president at Dillon Stores Division in August of 2016. She and her husband, Alan, reside here in Hutchinson. They have two sons, and we're very pleased to have her be part of our community and part of our conference today.
To talk at the Step Up Conference and share a little bit about my experience in the workforce. Now, I want to tell you, when they first called me, it sounded like a great idea. Okay, yeah, I'll come and talk, not a problem. And then I heard it was 45 minutes. I was like, oh my God, what am I going to talk about for 45 minutes about my career and my leadership and the things that I have worked on and things that I continue to work on. So every time that I will share with you, every time I start a meeting or a conference, or a call, I always share an uplift story. So let me get to, let me go back, Anyway, so I start every single meeting with an uplift story. What an uplift story is, I love to share stories with my team about something that another associate did as a random act of kindness for an associate or a customer within our store. And I want to read you this one that came about, it was probably 2 months ago. It was in February. And a lady posted it on Facebook about an experience she had in our marketplace right over here on 30th Street. And you know, it's the differences that we make in our associates' lives and our customers' lives that just gets that commitment and make them feel valued in everything they do. And I'm going to read it exactly word for word because if not, I can't say it as elegantly as this customer did. So Christine says, random act of kindness, a shout out to the young checkout named Aaron. We were checking out today and a gentleman ahead of us with special needs was buying a 2-liter bottle of soda. As he counted out his change, he realized he did not have enough to pay for it. And he became extremely apologetic for wasting everyone's time. The customer said, before I even had a chance to grab my wallet to pay for a soda, Aaron, the checker, had already pulled the change from his pocket and said, catch me next time. And it was all done. She said, if I had not been paying attention, I would have totally missed this random act of kindness. A couple of cents made a difference for someone. It's things like this that warm my heart and brings me back to guilt. So when you think about how you lead in your organization or in your role, it's really good, it's really great to share experiences that happen out in the field. For myself, it's for those that happen out in the stores and how we make a difference in everyone's life. Because it's the simple little things that happen that really make the difference. So let's talk a little bit about Colleen. They gave, you know, kind of the history about me. I was born and raised in Kansas, in Hays, Kansas, and when I was in kindergarten, I moved to Great Bend that I had my whole life there until I started moving with Dillons. Graduated from high school in 1981, started in Dillons in 1981 also. And as they said earlier, currently president of the Dillons Food Stores. I've been in my role for just a little bit over 7 months. I have 36 years with the company. I'm very proud of the tenure that I have. Especially when you think about at least my kids nowadays, they've been through, they're out of college and they've been through two or three jobs, and I can't quite understand how they can keep moving jobs because to me, when you've been with the company for 36 years, you're very, very committed to it. So I'm very proud to run the division and where I started, which is very, very proud of it. So anyway, a little bit about my career, and I know we went over a few steps in it. But again, I grew up in the town of Great Bend. My mother was a homemaker. She stayed at home. Of course, I have six sisters and one brother. So yes, it was always a challenge. And as of today, I'm still the mediator in the family. Because I was the third oldest. I have two older sisters. And then, of course, right after me came my brother. And he got everything that I was supposed to get, but I didn't yet. So I've always, you know, had a little bit of jealousy there. And then I had four younger sisters. But my father was in the oil field. He worked very, very hard. I really give him credit for the work ethic that I have today, as he worked many hours and did many, many things to make sure we were taken care of. And I would share with you, my family gave me the foundation of where I am today. They were very strong. My parents were very strong in faith. And they gave the faith to me to believe in myself and that I could do anything that I wanted to do. And they wanted to make sure, with having eight children, they wanted to make sure that they all had a college education and that they came and did what they wanted to do in their life to make them happy. So I give them so much credit, my parents and the foundation. So I went to college, as the state of the court, Martin County Community College, and I went there for a couple of years. I decided I was going to go into early childhood education. And I was in that career, and it was just kind of going along, and then I took an accounting class because I was trying to do early childhood care education. I was trying to develop a center at the women's shelter in Great Bend. And with that, I needed to have some accounting background that I didn't currently have. So as I was going to school and earning my degree, I started working at Dillon's, as I said, in 1981. At the same time, my husband, now of today, and still for many, many years, since 1984, we've been married, was working at Dillon's also. So I started as a bakery clerk, part-time, and that's back when we actually took donuts out of the case and put them in a little bag and wrote the price and handed it to you. So it's a little bit different than what we currently do today. Many things have changed through my career, as you know. But I followed my husband the first part of my career because I finished college, got my associate's degree, and then my husband was transferred to Garden City. So I followed him out there. He became a store manager, and at that time, I was a full-time associate that had been in quite a few departments but really didn't stand for anything. So I decided, you know what? I want to become a department head. I want to do something more. So I guess the reason why I wanted to do something more, the true reason when you get down to the bottom of it, was because department heads got bonuses, and by God, I wanted part of that bonus. And guess what? So I went to the seafood department. If you can imagine, the smelliest person in the whole store was me. I was the smelliest person, and guess what they did the year I became a department manager? Took away the bonus. They took away the bonus. So anyway, moving on, I had two children when I moved to Garden City, Matt and Mason, and I'll talk about them here in just a minute. From there, my husband was promoted to a store manager, so I followed him to Topeka, Kansas. And there I had a mentor that reached out to me. Her name was Wynn Dillon. She is retired now from the company, but she seen something in me that I didn't see. And she says, you know what, I think you can do more than you're currently doing. And so I share with you today, and I'll share this a couple of times, always think, who are you tapping on the shoulder and paying it forward to? Because someone took interest in you somewhere in your career. So moved to Topeka, became an assistant store manager, and then finally my day arrived, I became a store manager, and I was so excited. I thought I was done. I mean, I had made my goals. There was nothing more that I could want for. Maybe I'll open a new store someday. Ran a store in Topeka, ran a store in Lawrence, and then 2 days before Christmas, in 2001, the vice president of the company came in and and says, you know what, Colleen, we want you to be the district manager of some stores. And so a district manager actually is an area manager of about 20 stores. And at the time, my sons were young still, and my husband would be driving to Wichita to work. I would be moving to Hutchinson, where I didn't know anyone at the time. And I would be out in western Kansas, and my kids would be here every day, pretty much by themselves, as my husband was over in Wichita. It didn't feel right that I wanted to do it. I mean, my head was set. So I went home and talked to my husband, and he said, you know what, it's not right for the kids. We can't just leave them in a town and just be, you know, I'm an hour away, and you're a couple of hours away, it isn't right. So I turned that position down. As you know, that was probably one of the most devastating days of my life, because I thought my career was over. So I never thought, number one, I'd be a DM, that someone thought enough of me to become a district manager, and then I turned it down. And my message to you today is it's okay if it's not right for the family. So think about that as you grow your career. So incidentally, a couple months later, they came back to me and they said, we would like you to come to Hutchinson, Kansas and be the director of advertising. I said, really? And they said, yes, and you don't have to travel. You can be in the town where your kids are while they're going to school, and we're going to make it work for you. Well, guess what? I was able to move to Hutchinson. So I moved here then in 2001 as director of advertising, and 2 years later, I was named district manager of an area that where my husband had now, he was going to be in Hutchinson, and I was able to do the job that I really wanted to do. It just took a little bit longer than I thought it would. So from there, I became a district manager, and then 2008, the president called me up, and I was in Wichita, because by then I was district manager of the Wichita stores. And he called me up and he says, hey, where are you at? And I said, I'm at store 20, which is at Central and Rock. And he goes, oh, he goes, I thought we talked about you can't be in that store all the time. And I was like, oh, okay, I'm in trouble. You know, he goes, I need you to come back to the office. I said, oh, okay. So I go over the whole time, I'm thinking I'm in trouble. Oh my God, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? And it ended up he promoted me to vice president of operations for Dillon's store. Now, what I would share with you and everyone in here is that I was not ready for that position. I did not have all the tools and all the training that I need, and I went through a lot of bumps in the road as I did it. But that's one thing that I commit to myself going forward is I will never allow someone to be in a role that is not prepared for it. So think about that as you develop other people in your job or you're developing yourself. Make sure that you're prepared. Now, when I became vice president of operations, guess what? I wasn't following my husband anymore. I was in charge of my husband now. Now, think about that as you're sitting at the dinner table and he says, who made the decision? And you're kind of like, me? That was a great dinner, let me tell you. But it was good, but it became kind of a barrier, as I'll talk about here in just a little bit. So in 2012, I've been a VP for 4 years, and they came and said, you know what, we really think you can grow if you go to a different division. Would you be interested in moving to Salt Lake City? And I said, well, yeah, my kids were in college. Actually, one graduated, the other one's in third year of college. And I said, you know, I am interested in doing that. And at that time, my husband retired from the company, which is good. He retired at the age of 50. And, you know, you get a lot of flack sometimes when your husband doesn't quite work and, you know, people are looking at you and going, well, what's all that all about? But you know what? I am so proud that he is retired because he is allowing me to do the job I love. And I have fun at what I do, and I grew so much when I moved to Salt Lake. I grew both professionally and personally because I only knew what I knew working at Dillon's, but I've seen a whole different way to do things. I grew in my leadership because I didn't have all those emotional connections with the people that I grew up with. And I also grew personally with my husband because now we weren't talking about Dillon's all the time. We were actually counting on each other to get through every single day. So then move up to this last year. In July, I was asked if I would want to interview for a president's job. And I said, absolutely, I would love to. I feel that I'm ready. And they said, okay, well, we want you to go interview in Seattle. So we have a division up there called QFC. So yep, I went up there, did a market share study, went to Cincinnati for an 8-hour grueling interview, and thought I'd put my best foot forward. Well, of course, then it's the come and wait and see game, and you're waiting for that phone call, and 2 weeks later, the phone rang. And it wasn't the person who I thought it was going to be. And so I shared with them in my interview, I want to go back to submit an interview, that whenever they decide that I'm ready to be a president, just make sure it's a good fit for me, okay? So I go through the interview, get the call, and it's not the person who I thought it would be. So I pick up the phone, I call them back, and they said, well, we're not here to offer you today the presidents of QMC in Seattle. And again, I reiterate, thank you so much for the interview. And please also, when my time is right, when it's my time to become a president, make sure it's a good fit. And she said, well, I am here to offer you a president's position today. I'd like to offer you Dillons. And she said, now, I know you need to go home and you need to discuss with your husband. No, I don't. There is no discussing at all. So I chose a career after going back to all my career here, and of course I moved here. And do note that I did a lateral move, and it's okay to do a lateral move if you are willing to learn and grow differently. It's okay. It's okay to do that. Some don't see that being okay, but I was okay with it, and look where I am today. So, has there been roadblocks? Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't. So, has there been roadblocks? Absolutely. Many of you are probably still going through the challenges of having young kids. It's hard. It's hard to juggle, especially in retail. We're open 364 days a year, 24 hours a day, and things happen all the time. It is very, very hard. It was a challenge for me to have a husband working for the same company. It was definitely a challenge, but it worked out in the end. Something I struggle with still today that I will share with everyone is low self-confidence. I start second-guessing myself when I make a decision. And what I've learned now is once I make a decision, I go with it. I don't look back, what it could, should have. No time to do that. Make a decision and go with it. I also, earlier in my career, was so worried that everyone would like me. Oh my God, if somebody didn't like me, what was I going to do? And I took feedback from others so personally, which would make my confidence go down. But I'm telling you, I have learned that if you let other people's performance reflect on your performance, then you're never going to get anywhere. And that's why you have to be very honest with people. Very, very honest. So one last thing about me personally. I love to work hard, but I also like to play hard. And earlier in my career, thank goodness you didn't ask me to do the work-life balance like you originally told me to do, because early in my career, I was not an example of it. But I am committed today to every single person that works for me and my team, that they get the time they deserve to have fun. It is so important, because at the end of the day, it doesn't matter about work, it matters what you do with your family. So as you can see, I love to be outdoors. I like to experience life. Me and my husband always say, that was very good English, me and my husband. My husband and I always say, we are living life. Because that's what we have to do at the end of the day. So, love KU basketball. Love, love, love. They didn't help me this year. I was very disappointed when it was over. Love to go to Vegas and gamble. When I was at Smith's, I was in charge of 7 states as vice president of operations, and Vegas happened to be one of my areas, and that was really good. Love to take my boys on cruises. We go almost once a year, if not every other year. And, of course, my favorite. He's my absolute favorite. And let me tell you, when I got to meet him, he really did smell good. So when you think about how you get through your career and how you keep that family balance, I will tell you, these three men in my life, Alan and Matt and Mason, they are my rock, they are my biggest cheerleaders, and they support me every single day. And I am so blessed to have the family that I have that helps me continue to grow. So I have to give them credit in everything I do and where I am today. So going to why do I do what I do today? Why do I have the passion for my company? Well, let me tell you, we talked about this a little bit earlier. It's about the 12,500 associates that work for the Dillons team. And it's for the 1.5 million customers that come through our doors every single week to shop with us. They are counting on me to make the right decisions. And for 96 years, Dillons served Kansas communities So many of our friends and family had their first jobs at Dillons. If you, I mean, there's, you just don't know how you, you know, hey, I started at Dillons as a carryout, and then I've gone to another career. And I love it when I hear customers say, that's my Dillons. My store does this. My store does that. That's what drives me every single day and what I do. And let me tell you, look at the faces here of the 12,500 associates that care for 1.5 million of our customers every week. I take it all to heart. It's my personal commitment to make sure our associates succeed in whatever role they want to do, as long as we're serving our customers. And we have to bring the very best product to all of you who shop with us today to your table. So again, the one thing I will tell you in the 36 years I've had with the company, there is constant change, always change. And another thing where you can influence your business is that you have to be able to change. You know, as you know, the brick and mortar retailers right now across the country are really feeling pinched with the new online. Because you know what, our customers expect everything in immediate response. A click of a mouse, free shipping, express delivery right to the front door. You can get household goods, you can get food, you can get clothing, you can get diapers, you can get personal care items. You honestly can get anything to your front door right now. So as a grocery retailer serving customers, we have to find new ways to connect. We have to be relevant in the four walls of the store. So this is the most dangerous phrase that you can have in your career, both personally and professionally, if we've always done it that way. Well, guess what? If you always do it that way, you could be like these companies, right? And this has all happened since December this year. Think about that. And I put at the top, to change and improve yourself is giving yourself a second chance. To be forced by others to change is like being discarded. So you have to constantly change, both personally and professionally. You know, Amazon and the other players are changing the face of retail as we know it right now. And those who have resisted change are slowly being phased out. And that can happen to us within our jobs if we do not change. Because you know what, if you're catching up all the time, it's not sustainable for long-term success. You know, and I put that Nokia up here, because that's actually a few years ago when Microsoft bought Nokia. But the CEO quoted when they were being bought out, she said, you know what, we didn't do anything wrong, but somehow we lost. And you know, Nokia was a very, very respectable company. But the thing that they didn't do is they didn't change while the world was changing. And so they lost their chance of survival. But it is amazing. And just think here in Hutchinson how we're being affected. Kings is closing, Payless is closing. You know, it's just a continuing change in the retail business. So I go back to, again, to the slide of our Dillons associates. So how can we harness their passion of these individuals to keep serving our customer? How can I lead the team? So one way that we do it at Dillons and at Kroger is we have associate resource groups. And I want to share just a little bit about it. So this group allows a space for associates to connect and collaborate in a peer-to-peer setting, which creates a sense of belonging and fosters mentoring and an opportunity to achieve more together. So the first one was formed in Cincinnati, which is our general office. And they're formed by the people, of the people, and for the people. And it allows independence, and it allows flexibility to really serve the needs of its members. Okay, so each group has an executive sponsor, which you will hear in just a minute about the group that I sponsor, but it's driven by its members, and the foundation of the pillars that it has is only to offer a little bit of guidance. So the people within these groups are a resource for each other. And today, you can see, we have them clear across the United States. So we provide an avenue for associates to take ownership of their part of the business. So what are these ARG groups all about? Well, look at the ones that we have so far. We have 20 Women Edge, 4 African-American, 3 young professionals, 1 AOK, 1 Hispanic, and 1 multicultural. But look at the different groups and look at the Women's Edge. Women in this company want to connect with each other in a professional manner. We hear it very loud and clear. So I am so proud of Women's Edge. So, you will see that my company truly appreciates the influence of women in their leadership roles and the contributions that they make. So I know you may be thinking right now, okay, that's great, Colleen, but I don't work for Kroger, or I don't work for Dillons. Okay, if you want to. Okay. Anyway, so in all seriousness, Women's Action can be a great foundation for you. Think about the philosophy of an associate resource group and see how you can apply it in your experience today. There are over 100 ladies in this room here today that have their own unique experience that bring a whole different talent to the table and have the wealth of knowledge to offer. Share your business cards today. Start networking with each other and make a personal commitment to reach out to someone when you leave here today that you may not have known before. Because all of us are going through the same things through our career and we can help each other out. So I hope you find a way to connect outside of today. So, you know, we are all in charge of our own destiny. We need to engage, we need to develop ourselves, we need to grow, and we need to be empowered. So the mission of our Women's Edge group that I want to share with you is to attract, develop, and strengthen women by creating opportunities to grow valued leaders reflective of our associates and customers' demographics and enabling Kroger and Dillons to be the competitor of the future. So think about that in your area of business or where you work. Could you start a group to help each other out? It's pretty simple. It's not that hard to do. Does this sound like a work environment that you have in your company? If not, there's a challenge for you. And I will share with you, ladies, it wasn't for us either. Look at 1960. That was the face of Dillon's. And this came out of our archives, and it's a true photo of how we led the company. And then here is the Dillon's leadership today. It's a celebration of women. It's a celebration of diversity. And we continue to help support each other through the Women's Edge group. So we stand for leadership, innovation, growth, community, teamwork, excellent. We encourage each other, and we find each other's strengths. And these are all things that we aspire in our career, both personally and professionally. So don't forget about this as we talk about the Step Up Conference today and as we go through. So when you think about that, how do we support development? Things that we have done in the past, that we've had little seminars, and I did this out of Smith's, we actually had a seminar on biases. Many people don't realize how they do not make good decisions if you have biases in your mind. Okay? You don't even realize you have them, and you may make the wrong decision about the potential of someone. We have had seminars on dress for success. One thing that I would share with you is you need to dress for the position you want to be in. That's how you show that you are qualified and you feel good about yourself and you're ready to go. We've also had just a seminar on PowerPoint. How do you do a PowerPoint? It's amazing how you think everyone knows how to do one. Man, if you can do a little bit of seminar, how to do it, a little class, man, we can learn so much. We also give back to the community. We're very big in Race for the Cure, American Cancer Society. We did a lot of things for the Children's Hospital. We become involved in that. But we give back to the community because the community involvement is so well. The ladies love getting together and networking and educating each other. And I'll get more into mentoring and partnerships here in a little bit and collaboration. But again, you can start this ARG within your own place. So, you know, I've had the pleasure of being in Women's Edge for a long, long time. So 3 years. But it seems like forever because it's amazing to watch people grow. And I just want to show a short video of a recap of that showcases the first Women's Edge Summit that featured all the chapters from across Kroger coming together. So let me show you this quick video. Networking that helps us develop and helps us get through the day-to-day world. So, you know, why is this group important to me? And I've shared most of it here, but I do believe in the power and the influence of women within the business or within the role of wherever you work at. So it's time to pay it forward. That's why I believe in this so much. We have to recognize new leaders because, of course, we all can't be here forever, so we have to develop others. Find untapped new leadership, share experiences, boost leadership skills, instill confidence, and I'll talk about that here in just a minute again. Time to overcome your fears, create new opportunities, and really time to do something in order to succeed. So the ladies that represent our group at Dillon's is just incredible, and actually a few of them are here today. So if you have questions for them, go back in that little corner over there. They'd love to share their involvement in the Women's Edge. So I'm going to close here with telling you about my secrets to success that I feel that have helped me. And the first and foremost is stay true to yourself and your moral compass. Because there are times when things get really tough, and you get ready to behave in a way that isn't the way that you would normally behave. And the one thing that you always have to remember is you always have to have integrity, you always have to have respect, and you always have to make a person feel valued. So always stay true to that. And if you feel the pressures and you think you're going to flip, just stand back a minute and take a breath. Because it's not fair to that person who you're delivering that message to. Find work-life balance. I talked about that a little bit. Be a good listener. You know, there is nothing more irritating to me as if you're talking to someone and they all of a sudden get on their phone or they're typing as you're talking to them and that. Be a really good listener because it's amazing what you can learn when you listen. You have to also be a good speaker, but really listen. Listen, listen, listen. Thank people often. That is one thing that no one, I don't care who you are, does enough of. You have to make sure people feel valued and appreciated. You got to trust your team. You can't be a micromanager. You can't do it all. My God, if I tried to do it all, I would never get anything done in my life. You got to trust your people. And always be honest with them. Give them feedback. You got to celebrate the small wins. But man, when we fall short, we have to give coaching and feedback. We absolutely do. And you have to challenge your team to see themselves as more than they are today. Again, 99.5% of you in this room can do more than you're currently doing today. I promise you that. I know that just by the experiences I've been through. You can do more, but you have to open your mind that you can do more and want to do more than you're currently doing. And then, of course, you always, I just believe in paying it forward, is help others achieve their objectives, both professionally and personally. And at the end of the day, I want you all to know that I don't want to be known as the president of Dillons, because that's not who I see myself. I see myself as Alan's wife, as Matt and Mason's mom, as my mother's daughter, and granddaughter. I really think I'm a good sister, being a mediator with everyone. I love to have my friends. And I'd rather be known as a leader that other people want to emulate throughout their career. And you know, I share with you, as a female in a leadership role, it's a challenge. We all know that. Because if you're too tough, you're labeled, you know, what's wrong with her today? Man, she must have got up on the wrong side of the bed. She's a little tough today. And then if you're too motherly, you're too soft, you know? So for me as a leader, I had to strike a balance in there. And as I mentioned earlier in my career, I was too emotional. I was far more worried about maintaining relationships than to make the decisions with my head instead of with my heart, because I became so emotionally attached. And I didn't hold people to the expectations, but thanks to a lot of wonderful mentors along the way, they helped coach me on my leadership style, and I developed a more balanced approach. And the best compliment I ever received is when I was leaving SNCS to come here. They said in three words we can describe you, Colleen: you're firm, but you're fair. And that is the biggest compliment I've ever received. So, one thing you got to know, to be successful, you have to have a great team around you. So, I just share with you that with your team, or whoever reports to you, or who you work with, you have to make sure that they always know we're all in it together. And everything we do, we're all in it together. Everyone has to see the role in the big picture. You have to give and receive meaningful feedback and coach and develop others. You have to share the why. Keep your people informed. Make sure they know how their actions achieve success. Finally, have clear priorities so they know what matters most, and keep it simple. So, my goals for you today: have confidence. You make a difference. Do never think you don't make a difference in your role. And if you haven't read that book yet that they're going to give today, it's a great book because you do make a difference. Have a commitment to yourself and to others. And when I talk about commitment, do something for yourself too. Don't forget about that. I get up every morning at 5 a.m. and get on the treadmill for 3 miles. Now, do I want to get up at 5 a.m.? No. But why do I do it? Because you know what? When I'm done, I feel so much better about myself. I feel more relaxed. I'm very calm when I'm done. I'm a little sweaty. I'm very calm, and I have a better day. I promise you that. Empower. You empower yourself, your career path. You own it. No one else can own it for you. Capitalize on your strengths. Don't let your weaknesses hold you back. And I just spend one moment on mentees, mentors, and sponsors. Who are you mentoring today? If not, decide who you're going to mentor. Who's mentoring you? Thank them for what they are doing to help you. And know the difference between a mentor and a sponsor. A mentor talks to you about your leadership and helps coach you. A sponsor talks to somebody else about you and the high performance that you are doing in your job. So that's the difference between mentor and sponsor. So finally, look at these beautiful ladies. It's the faces of Dillons. These ladies, some are new to their career, some are veterans, but they're ready to be mentored and shaped for future generations. So I close with that I have personal pride when I see someone rise up and accomplish something they may not have otherwise been able to do. And the space between where I am today and where I want to be inspires me every single day. So again, today, know that anything is possible if you put your mind to it. As you've seen from my career, I thought I was only going to go this far, and I went a lot further than I ever thought I would. But have fun at what you do. You just love your job, and always pay it forward to someone else in the organization. So thank you.
From us before we break. Does anyone have a burning question about something she said that you'd like to know more about? Oh, come on. Don't let her off this.
Give me a tough one.
What's your best advice for starting, you know, a women's group of work in your community?
Okay, my best advice is to discuss with others who have some interest and let them run with it, to be honest with you, and give the guidance of, okay, I can help you move this resource group along. It has to be what they want to work on. And it can't be, because there's a lot of times I have a control issue sometimes, and I'll be in the meeting, I'll try to take over. But it has to be what they feel is most important to them. So you have to get a few people interested in it, and let me tell you, they will run with it once you find the interest.
Any others?
Oh, now we've got them.
Now we got them. Oh boy, I asked. Opened up the floodgate.
Colleen, what do you recommend for individuals that don't work for large companies like you do? How can those individuals create groups to empower women?
Right. So the thing that I can say the most that you can do that, because it is, I'm very fortunate to work for a large company, is that you can network with others within the same business. Maybe there might be other people that have the same careers as you. There's also, again, today, we have a lot of ladies in here that have different talents that you can use as a resource. And my goodness, you have the phone, call me, I'll give you my feedback. But it's hard, and there's different ways you can do it. The thing that comes to my mind is just getting with a group of friends and maybe just talking about the challenges that you have or the things that you use, or maybe that you give you some feedback to. I hope that helps. I don't know if I quite answered it the way that you would want. I don't have a clear answer, but there's a lot of women in here that
have been figured out.
Yeah.
We have time for one more question. Did I see another hand? Lena.
You've obviously worked within your company. Do you recommend doing that, or in this day and age, starting at a specific level and then moving up from there? Or jumping job to job?
Oh, well, of course, I'm the old timer that doesn't like jumping job to job. Like I said, my son calls me up. I think I'm going to change jobs. I'm like, you've only been there a year. Come on. It depends if you're having fun or what you do. That's what you have to decide. Now, jumping job to job, if you stay with the same company and doing something different, you grow and you learn new things. I highly recommend that. Getting out of your comfort zone. I'm very comfortable being uncomfortable. It makes me grow every single time. It's not the best place that you want to be. But I'm committed to Dillons. My whole career's been, they've been so good to my family that I have a hard time ever thinking about going to another place, to be honest with you. But whatever makes you and gives you your drive, that's the decision that you have to make. And be happy with what you do. You have to have fun in life. It's way too short. Okay? Very good.
Thank you, Colleen.
All right, I'm out of here.
In our own ways, in our own places. Also appreciate that you talked about Colleen, and all of you, your family, the roadblocks you faced, your mentors, a lot of flaws. It certainly resonated with me, and I could see similarities, and I see head nods around the room. So thank you for sharing that part of yourself with us too.
You're welcome.
We, on behalf of all of us, we have a gift basket for you.
Oh, very good. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Started down my path. Mary Grace, it looks like you're ready to begin.
Yeah, I'm very shy. I might not get this out of my hand now. No, I think one of the things I wish I had known when I started my career is how valuable constructive criticism is. Because as you go through your life and as you build your career, if the people that you work for, your mentors, you trust them, then you need to take the time to listen to what they're telling you. Because when they're giving you that advice, it's hard to hear. When they're giving you that information of what you can do to be better, if you don't take it in stride because you're injured or you think, well, they can't be wrong, they're wrong, they don't know what I do every day. What you need to do is put it aside, let the emotion work through, but take it, go back, and read it. I guarantee you'll find value in it. So don't be afraid of the things that people tell you you can improve upon, okay? Let your emotions, and I think Colleen said it very well, you need to put your emotions aside. You know, business is business. It's important that you continue to grow, and I think I'll just leave it at that.
Okay, thank you.
One thing for me, if I would have known when I started, is that business is ever changing, and it doesn't matter what you've went to school for, it doesn't matter what your background is, what education you've been to, or what conferences you've attended. You have to be willing to adjust and change day by day, hour by hour. There's not a day that goes by that I don't learn something new from somebody, from one of my staff, and I'm always trying to teach as well as learn. And so just being able to keep an open mind and knowing that what happened yesterday, today's or the next day is always a new day.
I think when I began working in higher ed in the 70s, I didn't realize that education was a political system like any other bureaucracy. And I think that's a hard thing for us to learn. We get into an occupation because we love the content. I loved learning, so I thought teaching, learning. I love this. Everybody in the association is going to be a learner. That's not true. And I think the thing that I learned that was probably the hardest is that my motivation teaching and learning was not everybody else's motivation. And that's kind of a tough thing to understand when you're eager and you're in love with your profession and you're learning and you're growing and you realize not everybody's there for the same purpose that you are there for. So there you go.
I wish that I knew when I started challenges that I would face simply because I'm a woman and not a man. When I was in law school, it felt to me like we're very equal. There were an equal number of women and men students, and it felt to me like the history that we've all heard about the difficulties that, I mean, a lot of my law school professors were women and talked about their classroom experience where they were one, maybe the only woman in the classroom at the time. So being in law school and seeing such an equal representation, I thought that was going to translate into the real world. And I think that it does translate in a lot of professions or settings, but in my experience in law, it has not, that equality that I saw in law school has not applied to my everyday experiences as a lawyer. I have, and even out of law school, felt like I started working with a lot of other women attorneys. But as the years have gone on, a lot of women attorneys have either taken jobs that allowed them to handle family better, or have dropped out of the workforce entirely. And in the type of law that I practice, that has resulted in, I now find myself regularly the only woman in the room many times. And in that situation, I see, and I wish that I knew, were the subtle things, the subtle ways in which I would be treated differently as a woman. Frequently have situations where judges allow my male opponent to speak first or you know, run the conversation. I have lots of experiences with people who, despite the fact that my name is on the firm and takes up the same amount of spots as my partner, people, if they don't like what I have to say, will ask to speak to my boss. It's kind of a regular occurrence, surprisingly to me. It's still surprising, but I wish I knew that when I started, that it really does have an effect.
Well, thinking way back, what I wish I would have known when I first started, based on what I know now, is that it's okay to not know everything, that I'm not going to have all the answers. And I also wish I would have known that at the very beginning, I needed to have surrounded myself with people who know more than I do. And that's what I do today, and have learned that it makes my job a whole lot easier to have people that are smarter than I am, to have people who do their job better than I could ever do it, because it makes me look good, it makes the organization look good, and it just creates a synergy that is unstoppable. So I appreciate having people around me that are smarter than I am, brighter than I am, and more talented than I am.
Thank you to all of you for that first answer. I have a follow-up question, unless somebody has something burning to follow up on that. I have another question. All right. I recently read the book Lean In, which Brenton Young Law Firm is providing to all of us today at the end of the conference if you turn in an evaluation. Say that now. It's a great book by Sheryl Sandberg, and she addresses in there this concept of fake it until you make it. Is that something that I've heard often in TED Talks and read about? And I wonder, for each of you, do you believe in fake it till you make it? And if you do, have you used it?
I'll start. I have tried to fake it till you make it, and I think it's a dangerous concept. I think it has worked on occasion, but again, if you go back to, you don't have to know everything, and it's okay to say you don't know, but that you can find out. I would much prefer to do that than to try to fake my way through or bluff my way through a conversation to have then be proven wrong, or someone who didn't know what they were talking about, or worse yet, to think that I had been telling an untruth.
I think I agree that there's a balance there of, on one hand, believing in yourself, and even if you don't know everything, still doing it and trying to do it. So I guess when I hear fake it till you make it, it's more, in my mind, it means making yourself do things, as I think Colleen mentioned, that make you uncomfortable sometimes because maybe you don't know how to do it. But I agree, at the same time, you have to be genuine to who you are, and if you're not, the people around you will recognize that. So it is okay to acknowledge that you don't know everything and let's still try.
I think too, in the 70s or 80s, I think Harriet Lerner wrote a book called Dance with Anger. And in the prototype, in the front of the book, in the prologue, she said women get categorized two ways. They're either nice girls or they're bitches. And so I think some of us are forced into the role of faking the nice girl thing to make something get accomplished. And so I would say that's probably harder for a strong woman leader to go around with the pacification of being nice, because if you're too strong or you're too direct or you're too aggressive, life's going to be hard for you and no goals are going to get accomplished. So you're going to have to find a happy medium here, even though Harriet Lerner never said that. There's going to have to be this strength in your character of challenging and questioning, which I think the B word denotes, and also playing well with others. So that part you may have to fake it till you make it.
I definitely agree with what everybody has said so far. Being a small business owner and being in a role where I am not only a small business owner, but a young female in business, it does become difficult, and especially when I'm put on the spot on different things and when I need to be the one to know the answer. I work with my husband, and a lot of times, sometimes I may be asked the same question as he is, and they're going to take what he says over what I say. And I understand that, and sometimes there's adequacy to that. Sometimes I don't, you know, I get a little frustrated, but I always try my best to give the best answer and to make the best decisions I can. But there's times when I don't know everything and I'm not going to, and I'm not afraid to admit that. I feel like I've got a lot of learning years ahead of me. There's still a lot for me to know.
I would agree with everything they said. I working in a corporation, all male corporation, and my experience as a vice president, you would walk into a room knowing that your voice was going to be asked upon, but when it was time. And I think the thing that you need to realize is sometimes the person that speaks the least is the one that has the most power. I think you need to know your audience, and you need to not be afraid to speak your mind. But it needs to be well thought out. You can't be afraid to make mistakes. So fake it till you make it. If you're afraid of walking out on that ledge, you're never going to have a chance, a challenge, or improve your quality of life. So in essence, when you go out into business, we all are faking it until we make it. Educate yourself. You need to put the work in and work hard, and that opportunity, as you face it, will be a success in your future.
All right. One more question, then it's your turn. Yes, I have my own microphone here. All of you, by all standards, have been very successful in your endeavors. I'm sure they haven't all been successful, but sitting where you are today, the positions you're in, and what you're doing in your businesses and companies and organizations would be defined as successful. Would you, looking back at the beginning, or even today, would you describe yourself at any point as having been ambitious?
Absolutely, absolutely. I remember one time I had was getting my first evaluation from my boss, and I had goals. I knew where I wanted to go. And during the evaluation, I looked at him and I said, "Just know I'm going to be your hardest worker. I'm going to put the time in, and I'm going to work hard. But I expect you to do your job, and your job is to get me here." And I laid it out full force and said, "I'm going to be a vice president. I'm going to put the work in, and I'm going to do the job, and I'm going to earn that title. But your job is to award it to me, and I expect you to."
I feel like out of high school, I was very very ambitious. I was driven. I knew exactly what I wanted. But also at the same catch of that, I remember having my evaluations and speaking with my supervisor, and those were superior to me. And I remember feeling at a young age, thinking back, that I also felt entitled at the same time, where I felt like I was ambitious, but that I always deserved more and wanted more. And if I could go back on that, I would definitely change my thoughts on that and really just take the time to soak up all the information, all the great resources that I always had around me, versus always thinking in the back of my mind, maybe I could do that better, I can be better than that, I should be doing this, and just enjoying the moment that it is. And I try to be a mentor to some of my staff and some people that I work with, and also share those experiences with them on, you may not be where you want to be right now, but be patient and good things will come.
Yeah, I think I was academically ambitious. I got a baccalaureate degree in 3 years, I got a master's degree in 2 years, and I got a doctorate in 3 years. Not all in succession, but academics was always my love, and I think you have to pursue that. I also did not want to live in the little town that my parents raised me in, even though I love the little town now. Because I didn't want to spend Friday night drinking beer and bowling. So I thought, my life, I wanted to travel, I wanted to see the world, I wanted to meet people, I wanted to enjoy things that, you know, I was never afforded as a child. So I guess if that's ambition, I had it. And I thought as an academic, you kind of have a ticket to the world, but you have to get those degrees. You cannot get into an educational environment without the degrees. Even if you speed through them, and you have to learn afterwards, as these ladies all said, because you don't learn everything in a college education class. You don't learn everything getting a degree. There's a lot of experience that you learn as you grow and live and breathe and work. I have learned so much from the people that I've worked with, so I've appreciated that. But I would probably have to say yes, I was ambitious.
I guess the lawyer in me thinks, well, it depends on how you define ambitious.
But, and I have to say that I haven't ever thought about myself as, I'm ambitious, I'm going to conquer the world. I have heard others say that about me, and I have to say that I've been surprised a little bit when I've heard that. I think for me, I didn't start out thinking, I'm going to get to this position, or I'm going to, you know, achieve these certain things. Instead, it's always, for me, just been about the desire to learn more and become better at what I like to do. And that has just kind of naturally, moved me through to this position. So I think the love of learning and recognizing that I don't know everything now, and there's always something that I can do to become better. This is really what has moved me.
Well, my mother would say that I was probably ambitious from the day I arrived, but I never would have probably considered myself ambitious by my own standards. But as you reflect back, you realize that, you know, you were kind of the leader of the play group. You tried to take over for the Girl Scout leader. You were like top sales Girl Scout cookie person. You were always, or I was always, assuming lead roles with whatever activity I was in. And it just kind of became natural that as I entered a professional career, that there was always more that I wanted to do, because I felt I could make more of an impact in the decision-making process, and I could make things better for the people that I was working with and for. So I today do consider myself ambitious. Status quo isn't really where I want to be. I always want to have more, I want to do better, not just for myself, but for the organization that I work for and for the people that that represents. So yes, I'm probably ambitious.
Thank you for those answers. I appreciate it. Your thoughts and insight there. Let's find out what you'd like to know more about. Don't be shy.
Okay. What is your best time-saving tip, either at work or at home?
My best time-saving tip is to give it away. I mean, I don't have to do everything. I do not have to touch everything. And when I give it away, I also accept what I get back. You know, and it's also my job to kind of monitor it and keep an eye on it. But if it comes in and it's different than what I expected, you know, that difference is okay. It doesn't have to be quite like I did it or would do it. Give it away.
My best time-saving tip for myself is to make a list. I make a list every day, categorize it by what's my priority. With what I do, I wear a lot of hats throughout the day, and when I start my day and I'm going into work, usually it's the total opposite of what I end up doing, because I just never know what's gonna come up. So I make my list, I look at it, I know what my priorities are for that day, and some things get pushed off to the next day or maybe into the evening, but I feel like for me, that's what saves me time, is being able to go back and look at what I need to do and what I need to accomplish throughout the day.
I would just agree, the hardest thing for me to ever learn is delegation. Delegation is scary if you're somewhat of a control person, but you have to trust, and I completely agree that you have to build a team that you trust. You have to find the people to mentor. I was always training my replacement, always was looking who is going to take my role, because if I had a strong team, then I could take on other tasks and other responsibilities. So, but delegation is absolutely the hardest thing to learn, and that's what you have to do in order to move up the ladder.
I need help with that.
I'm also a list maker, and there's nothing more satisfying to me than being able to cross off my list and prioritizing that list, because as you do, you come into work, you think you have your day planned. Someone else has a plan for you.
I don't know about you, but I sometimes write things on the list I just did. Yeah. Right up here, we have a question.
As far as your mentors and...
Archer, will you wait to the microphone?
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
In your careers and your lives, and looking at mentors, people that you know have really made a difference in your growth, were those people that you chose, or did they come into your life? And if you did choose them, how would you go about that? If you had someone in mind you'd like to learn from, or how would you approach that, or how would I do that?
Well, from my experience, I had some mentors that chose me, and I didn't necessarily know it at the time. And others I tried to choose for myself, but I often found that it was the mentor who chose me that really ended up making the most significant impact in my professional career, and sometimes also in your personal life. But mentors were not only just women. I had men mentors as well that helped with the leadership growth and pushing you to extremes of doing things that were maybe outside of your comfort zone. So when you look for a mentor, or a mentor is looking for you, don't believe that it only has to be a woman, because it can also be a man who is wanting to see women excel. Because it's more about the leadership, not about the gender.
I echo those thoughts as well. I think that most of the mentors in my life have been male, and I speculate, I suppose, that maybe that's result of there being around more men, but have certainly benefited from those relationships. And I think there are certain people that we all see that you think, boy, I'd really like them to mentor me, but I haven't ever seen a real fruitful relationship come out of that, unfortunately, which kind of sounds like we're saying we'll just sit there and wait for somebody to mentor us. Instead, I think maybe it's recognizing the people around you that believe in you and allowing yourself to believe in yourself as well.
I think the other thing is your supervisors all watch you every day, and they see that you have certain traits and abilities, and if you excel at those, you go the extra mile, you give an extra paper, you research something, you say, here's something I've done. Our boss used to walk in at a different college and he would lay 100 ideas on our desk with my teammate, and we'd look at him like, are you kidding? We can't get all that crap done in a day. And so he would say to us, I knew you couldn't do that, but you picked out what you thought could work given the culture, which I think is a very important point to being here with you all, is that the culture of your organization is very important in what you do and how you do it. But I think that your supervisor, whoever it is your first place to start, because they have the power to help move you along in your career. And if they choose you, or they help you, or you prove that you are going to go above and beyond the extra mile, they will look at you differently. They will say, hey, yeah, there's something here about this person, something extra special. And as you said, I had a lot of male mentors, because in teaching, we had teachers, we had secretaries, and we had librarians. Everybody else was male. So, you know, it's pretty hard to break through that glass ceiling. And the women that did break through it were not necessarily willing to help someone come along underneath. And I am not doing that at Hutchinson Community College. I have a pretty neat staff of young women who are all willing and able and capable, and we have a great relationship. But I think that's your job, to form that relationship. So you have to work at it, and you have to let them know that they are capable and can do more, and you have to be open to that.
And I think sometimes you can have a mentor in somebody that you're very passionate about that maybe you don't even realize is your mentor to begin with. It starts out as maybe somebody you've worked with, worked for, or just are really good friends with. And I think just the learning that you can take from that and having somebody just to be able to reach out to. For me, being in small business and being my own boss, sometimes that is a struggle for me to know who to reach out to and who's available for me. You don't want to feel like an inconvenience. You don't want to bother somebody when you know everybody is busy. But just reaching out to somebody, following them, reading about maybe what they wrote about on the blog. Those are the things that sometimes help me through, where maybe they don't even know they're my mentor, but I look up to them and I look forward to hearing from them and any advice.
I agree with all the comments. The last thing I would probably say is listening. Your people all around, and you never know the gems that you're encountering each and every day, whether it's people that work with you, work for you, or you work for. You know, you don't know all their stories. Listening to them and taking time to actually have a conversation. I can be in a room today, and I will watch people and learn from them how there's an opportunity in every day. You have an opportunity to learn from other people, and you need to embrace that, because whether it's how you can speak to someone differently, how you can approach people, there's always an opportunity to learn. So I've definitely had people that have mentored me in many facets of my career. And I am probably the thing I'm most proud of is the people that have said to me how much I've helped and they've aspired and helped their career. And that to me is success.
Other question?
Let's see, I grew up here. And left when I was about 22 because I didn't see a way to have the life I wanted, and a lot of it was gender. Roles were pretty rigid. And I moved back 2 years ago because my parents were getting older. Honestly, I've been sort of disappointed because I've lived other parts of the country for a long time. I lived in Louisville, Kentucky for about 18 years before I moved back, which might not seem like that far advanced, but I have found it very tiring to fake the nice girl bit. And I find I have to do that a lot. And so for Dr. Haas, my question is, how do you do that every day with any of the rest of you so that you get things done? But I do feel like a lot of times things that I would say that any man where I work could say, they look at me like, I can't believe she's in a mood again or whatever. how do you deal with that?
Yeah, I'm beyond faking it now. You know, I'm old enough to wear purple, so everybody at the college kind of knows.
goes, well, okay, Dr. Ross is going to just kind of tell you the way it is. What I try not to do, though, is step on people's feelings or step on relationships, because we all need each other. And I think everybody at the institution is trying to do a good job. I presume that when they come in. So I think my job is tact and trying to persuade someone. We ought to look at this many ways to Sunday. That my answer may not be the only answer, but I think early on in my career, I thought I always had to be smiling and happy and nice, and then go home and go, oh, that was awful. So I don't go home and do that anymore. I try to give it my 100% while I'm there during the day. I still feel like it's education is still predominantly male. The women who have gotten ahead don't particularly help those that come behind, and I'm trying to break that barrier, because I think there's a lot of importance in men and women working together in a career field. But I would say don't fake it. Be sincere, be honest, be yourself, and if you can't do that, be by yourself.
That I will say, though, that I think it's interesting to hear you say that you have experiences in other places that sound like maybe in those places you didn't have to pretend to be as nice as it feels like maybe you have to be here. But I guess what I would mention is that I try, and I think all of us should try to recognize the part that we play in expecting a certain attitude or niceness from the women around us. It's easy to think, the men have this attitude and, we are enlightened and see that this is how it should be, but I find that just as many women expect us to be nice as men do. So I think just being aware of that and recognizing what are you expecting of other people and checking yourself, truly. I was in front of a female judge recently and I left the courtroom thinking, she doesn't seem very confident or something. And I thought, have I ever thought that about a male judge? And why did I think that about her? And so I think it's recognizing if you don't like the way somebody has approached you with something, is it because they're a woman, or what part does the fact that they're a woman play in that attitude? I think that's where we change that.
Anyone else?
The only thing I would add to that is, there's a place and time to be firm. I also feel that the two things you can't train people are common sense and tact. And you have to approach, sometimes you gather your thoughts and approach it with that in mind. And to make sure that you have a clear, concise message, you deliver it in a way that's not threatening. And you can always deliver your message without tearing down someone's self-respect. Sometimes being right is not the most important thing. It's just knowing your audience. And every person, you have to know who you're going to approach. If I want to talk to Aubrey about an issue, I need to really think a minute about Aubrey to make sure how I'm going to approach her, which would be different than someone else. So you need to know who you're going to talk to. You need to invest the time to make sure that you're prepared to talk to that person about that issue.
Another question from the audience.
In your experiences, I would just like to ask what advice you can give us to overcome any barriers or hardships that we may have in our lives or careers as we go along.
Life happens. It happens to everyone. In my career, one of the first things that was bestowed upon me that I was always going to give my employees is that family matters. And if they're not in a place where they can be productive They don't need, you need to help support them in that, you know? However you can, whatever limitations you have. Everyone has a life. Everyone doesn't want to bring their life to work. Don't be that person that you don't want to work with. Because if you've ever been 30,000 feet in the air, as I would tell my employees, don't be the person that no one wants to work with. Don't be the person that's constantly telling you every little bit of story about this happened, that happened, and that happened. That drains on people. If you've, come on, you've all been there working with that one employee that's just, you can't listen again. I mean, you want to listen and be compassionate, but you also have a job to do. Don't be that person, number one. And I will tell you that one of the few things you get to control in this world is what you do for a living. And you need to do something that you're passionate about. And there's a way to pay the bills, and there's a way to follow your passion. And as life happens, sometimes it makes you, forces you into a different area. I mean, I've been in the situation where I've had family scenarios that you've had to deal with, and I think as you can support your employees and give them the compassion they deserve, they will come back and be threefold the employee you ever expected them to be.
I think one thing as businesswomen, whether we are a retail sales clerk up to a CFO of a company, is that we all have the pressure to be perfect. And we always feel like we have to be perfect, and that we always have to have the right answer. We always have to have the smile on our face, and we always have to be the best we can be. And some days are not that easy. Some days we can't do that, and we are human. And I think realizing that we're not perfect and that we can always learn, those are the challenges that I know I face. For me, I feel like I've got to have my game face on no matter where I am, 7 days a week, whether I'm shopping at Dillon's, I'm at the grocery store with a hat on, not really wanting to see anybody and chalk to anybody, I'm gonna see people, and I need to be able to talk to people. And I think that pressure to be perfect, sometimes we go home at night and it just kills me. And I think, gosh, why am I in this role? Why do I always push myself? But I also think that the reason I am in the place I am today is because I have pushed myself. And I think just realizing that some days are better than others, and some days we're gonna be better than better people and better business owners and employees than what we're gonna be on other days. So we're not all perfect.
I think too, the best thing you can do is love yourself. Love yourself, that you deserve a break. You're the mother, you're the caregiver, you're the attorney, you're the doctor, you're the, our roles are multifaceted and we have to do everything for everybody. When do you take a break for yourself? When do you have a little retail therapy? When do you have a nice glass of wine? When do you just go for a walk? You have to plan those things in your day, put them on your list, so that you say to yourself, self, you get this little break here. You've worked yourself into a frenzy, and you deserve 5 minutes. Or you're gonna go have a nice lunch instead of 5 minutes at your desk. And then you were probably all, none of you born at the time this TV show was on, Hee Haw, and the guy would say, well, I have bad news. And the other guy would say, well, you know, and he'd talk it down. And the other guy said, but that's really good news. And sometimes you have to make good news out of bad news. You have to find the best thing of whatever it is in the rotten thing that just happened. And so, and you have to carry that attitude. That attitude will carry you through a lot of things, even things that we don't like. And every day has to be a new day. It has to be 51st days, ladies. Every day is a new day, and you're starting over. Because it's a fresh day. And don't carry whatever happened yesterday to the workplace or to your colleagues.
I would just add that I think it's easy to feel when you have obstacles, to feel like you're the only one who has had those obstacles. And it's easy to look at a boss or someone and think, you know, I'm sure she's never had that before, and if I didn't have it, I'd be able to be where she is. But I think the reality is that everyone has had experiences that we don't all share all the time. That everyone has overcome some obstacles and still made it through. In recognizing who you can rely on. I agree that you shouldn't bring it all to the workplace and focus on it all day long, but recognizing who in your life can support you and help you, and sometimes really confiding in someone will, you know, you'll learn the obstacles that they also have experienced. And in, for me, I know whenever I've had those experiences to learn, someone else has had an experience just like mine has been helpful in recognizing that I'll be able to get through that.
And probably two pieces of advice. One is to try not to be the type E woman, trying to be everything to everybody, because you will never be the perfect mom, the perfect boss, the perfect employee, perfect spouse, the perfect lover, the perfect church-going woman. You're never going to be everything to everyone, so be true to who you are. The second piece of advice was given to me as I entered into a management field way back in the 80s, and it was just on a little card that I have kept with me all of these years. And it says, you need to act like a man, work like a dog, and think like a woman.
Your questions have been fantastic. I think we have time for one, maybe two more. I'd like to receive it from the audience.
This conference isn't for you, but so I'm stuck with that on the line as a man. If we look at why we're doing this conference, one of the things we saw with our score statistically is that 65-67% of the new business starts are by women. Federal Reserve at Kansas City does this, says the same thing. At the Quest Center for Entrepreneurs, 80% of my clients are women that I have loans with. Why is this?
Do you have that answer?
I have a suggestion.
You know, I've been to a lot of educational conferences, and one thing that I've learned about Kansas is that Midwesterners are very creative. We take nothing and make something out of it. And when our state looks at the economy, people here learn to take a raw product and make something that is marketable. And so when I worked in Topeka, there are a lot of people here that take raw material and make a product that's sellable at some other parts of the country, and they don't know how to do that. They don't have that ingenuity to take take an A and a B and make a C and sell it, or sell a good idea, or market a good idea. Also, I think the Midwesterners are pretty much fixers. We will take something apart, put it back together, and it's a new thing for us. It's an invention, it's creative. When I worked in the state of Washington, I didn't see that. I saw a lot of entitlement mentality. I saw people that said, government, please give me a paycheck. In Kansas, people want to work. They're industrious. We're kind of like a little ant society. We want to make something happen here. We want to create and to work and to earn our own paycheck. So that would be my statement, is that Kansans, Midwesterners, Nebraskans really are industrious peoples, and I appreciate that about it. And that's why I moved back home.
I guess I'm curious to know how many of those businesses succeed. Do you have those statistics?
Well, at the Quest Center, we have about an 80% after 3 years that succeed. So, and again, that 80%, not all women, but 80% of my loan clients are women.
I would wonder if we have, I think as a culture, we've really tried to, and in a lot of ways, changed in empowering women to believe that they can succeed in business, and empowering them to start new businesses where maybe 10, 20, 30 years ago they wouldn't have even thought to do that. So I think that my guess is that in general we recognize the value that we have to add to our society and in business.
I don't know if you know about Nebraska Furniture Mart's story, but Mrs. O started her business in the basement of her husband's pawn shop. And so he had the pawn shop up above, and she started Nebraska Furniture Mart down below. You don't hear about the pawn shop anymore, but Nebraska Furniture Mart is everywhere.
I would also add that I think that women are inclined to reach out for help, and that's what the Quest Center is doing, is providing that type of mentoring, and the loans definitely are a great tool. And many women will go seek help pretty readily, and then thankfully the Quest Center is there to do that.
So ask Dave why he thinks
so. Yeah, do you want to tell us your best guess for why that's true?
My best guess is that at the present time, I think a lot of our generation, or the women, are actually focusing on the family and the fact that, you know, if you're going to be a family, you really need to be a two breadwinner family in order to survive in today's environment. That's my best guess. And I never asked for directions.
We have time for one more question. Up here, Leah has a question.
They've actually started me out on
the show. You all have to wait for the mic. That's everyone.
Dave actually started my question out. My views starting out in college are completely different than now. I always told my friends I was going to have a stay-at-home husband, and he was going to cook and clean and do all that, and then I was going to be the one that did the business. So business and family, how do you think we can tell women that it's okay to have both? You can have both. It's possible. How would you encourage future generations and generations now that it's okay to have both, and how do you yourself deal with having a family and a business?
Yeah. For me, I feel like it's a constant juggle. I have to always make the effort to make time for myself, make time for things at my house, make time for my family, and I'm not always good at that. And there's times, there's months, there's been years where I have not been a good daughter, I've not been a good wife, I've not been the best I can be, but I try it because I'm trying to be the best I can be at my work and at my career. Just finding the balance, trial and error, figuring out what works. Everybody's situation is going to be different. My situation, I know, is different from my husband's. And, you know, he and I's life to work balance is so different. But I try not to compare what works for me to what works for him, because we're different people. And in the end, we have a business together and we both work hard. But I have gotten a lot better about making time for myself and figuring out when that works.
Well, I don't have children, so it makes me an expert on the subject. But what I can say is, from a leadership perspective, you know, whether it's men or women, I think you can have a career and a family. From a boss, I think it's important to be able to recognize the need for flexibility when you have families. Or employees who have families that are working with you or for you. Flexible work schedule, you know, and I'll tell you, I've learned more about this in the last 10 years of my career, certainly than in the first 20 or 25 years of the career. It took me a while, I'm a slow learner. But the flexibility that you're able to offer your employees, because family is important. Kids have opportunity to have, you know, your first dance recital. That happens one time. You know, can you really afford to not let your staff person off duty to go see that? You know, a dad wants to go to his kid's first baseball game. Can you really deny somebody that? You know, and I think that just creates such a better work environment for everyone. And it's making sure that you have the right fit for your job or for your profession with the right company that promotes the culture and understands that business isn't the end all. It's a good part of it, but it's not the end all.
I will say that I have an 8-year-old daughter. So I'll tell you that it's super hard. So you hear people say, you can have both, and obviously you can, but it's hard. And I think anybody who suggests that it's easy is nuts. I can tell you I spend a lot of time feeling guilty, feeling like I should be at something that I wasn't able to make it to. But what I draw comfort from is recognizing, hopefully, the benefit that my daughter is getting from me not always being there. And fortunately, I have a husband who is very involved and is usually able to go to the events that I'm not. And also have other family around. But I do think that for anyone who decides to have both a career and family, they should recognize going into it that they will need support and they cannot do it all themselves. They can't be a fantastic parent that's there for everything and a fantastic CEO and handling everything at work. It's just not possible and it's not realistic for us to expect that of ourselves. And the only way that it really can happen is to allow people to help them do it.
There's a concept called the myth of perfection. Get over it. I mean, there's going to be dirt on the floor. There's going to be messy laundry. There's going to be problems. And be happy about it.
I think finally, the only thing I would just say is that it's hard for any one of us to say what's right for you because your life has to be right and your passions are yours and you have to find the balance because you have to have balance. There's a quality of life that things are gonna fall short and you get to decide, you know, what's the best version for you and just follow that. Because there's no cookie cutter way. Just be true to yourself and follow your passion.
That's a great way to end it, wasn't it?